It's the question every organisation hopes they'll never have to answer. How will your business cope when disaster strikes? One company that knows is insurance giant Aflac, who proved that when it comes to continuity, there's no substitute for proper planning and preparation. Quite apart from the obvious human cost, the earthquake and tsunami that hit Japan in March 2011 provided a reminder of how suddenly your business can be turned upside down by events outside your control. Yet, while many are still counting the cost of that devastating event, Aflac, for whom around 75% of revenues come from the Japanese market, was able to weather the storm better than most. How? By ensuring it had a well-structured, well-rehearsed business continuity plan in place. I caught up with John Moorefield, Aflac's SVP of Strategic Management, to find out what that plan involved and how the company responded.
You can't do in the extraordinary what you're not prepared to do in the ordinary. And our preparation, I think, was exemplary in the limited amount of challenges we had immediately after the quake. So on a human level, you can't prepare yourself for that, but you work through it. One of the great things about the Japanese culture is a commitment to carry on. That was a real saving grace in my mind in terms of our operation. They were able to focus on doing what we need to do. Our insurance exists to help people in their time of need. So whether you have cancer, whether you have an accident, whether you're disabled, we're there to get cash in your hand so that you can get through that crisis. So it's absolutely critical that our team stepped up and immediately responded to those people's needs. And they did. And they did in a way that just was, you know, inspiring. That said, as the time went on, I think what everyone in Japan struggled with, not just Aflac, but every company, manufacturers, you name it, in whatever sector, was the power grid challenges that followed when, due to the disruption of a number of the power generating facilities such as Fukushima, that significantly culled back the power available. There were rolling blackouts, requirements from the government to shut down power use, so removing every other bulb, for example, shutting lights off at lunch, shutting lights off at a certain time at night. All of those requirements, increasing the temperature that you cool your facility at, so you're dealing with your AC set at 28 degrees C in your office, things of those nature. Anyone was quite prepared for the length of time that those conditions were put in place.
So what role did technology play in allowing you to go about business as usual, albeit, you know, with the caveat that that term doesn't mean much in a disaster of this scale?
So fortunately, we had spent a significant amount of company time and money over the previous 5 years to harden our technology infrastructure, both our data centers and our networks. And so it's hard to say what would have happened in the event we had not done that, but it was awfully assuring in the fact that those weren't challenges to us. We took those challenges off the table. Other than the electricity availability and the power generation availability monitoring that we had to do, we were almost unaffected at a business level by that. We were prepared in a way that removed a lot of the doubt about were we going to be able to maintain our business. That's a commitment at an executive level because there is no upfront return on investment for those kind of expenditures. And they're not revenue generation, they're pure expense. But here in living the reality when you have so many other things that you have to take care of, not worrying about whether you can bring your system back up is just an enormous relief and allows the company management to focus on other things.
So what type of steps did you take in order to harden your stance in the event of a disaster such as this?
So we had both moved to a world-class data center which could withstand actually a much larger earthquake than occurred, even if it had occurred closer to the data center. We also have distributed our data centers both east and west. One of the flaws we found in our own model early on, and many companies still have this flaw, is those they put both of their data centers in the Tokyo area. Well, Tokyo is the most seismically active metropolitan area in the world. If you're going to have a major event, it's likely that, and you have both of your data centers closely located, it's likely you're going to have challenges. So we had actually distributed our data centers, one in eastern Japan, one in western Japan. We also had duplicated our networks across multiple vendors with a fairly high resiliency model. So there was significant inlaid technology build out that unless something truly catastrophic hit both sides of Japan and simultaneously, we were going to be able to service our business.
So how important is it to have a sort of a multi-layered plan whereby you've kind of tried to cover as many different eventualities as possible?
It's absolutely essential. While you're in Tokyo and the highest probability will be earthquake, no one thought the tsunami itself would have the significant impact. The earthquake was significant, but it was the tsunami that really had the impact. There are other types of disasters, whether natural or man-made, that could occur that you just need to be prepared for. You need to be prepared for on a human level. How do you ensure that your employees and your partners are safe and able to continue? How do you move them to a place where they're able to work if your current structure is unavailable for whatever reason? How do you ensure that the technology is available? How do you ensure your communication network is up and working while also at the same time being able to provide information to regulatory agencies and to your investor community? One of the things that was very important was our ability to within hours to predict the impact on claims and predict the impact on sales to our analyst community. And so thinking through all of your constituencies you have to communicate to, thinking through all the constituencies that you have to take care of, and the business processes and technology that you have to support is absolutely critical to being able to look yourself in the eye, look your regulators in the eye, and look at your external constituencies, your policyholders and your investors, and say you're going to be there in your customer's time of need.
If you were to put together a business continuity plan or make any recommendations for putting together a business continuity plan, what would be the three most critical areas for you to address?
In my opinion, again, the first, how are you going to assess the damage at a human, structural, and technology level? How do you quickly assess that in order to understand what the state is and what you're going to have to do to recover? Obviously, disaster recovery assumes you know what you're recovering. Second, preparation in order to ensure a an ability to recover and have continuity, which means distribution of workload, distribution of people, distribution of technology, in order to avoid concentration risk. And then third is practice. Anytime you do a plan, in theory, you have holes. A disaster recovery plan on paper is only as good as the weight of the paper you have on it. Until it's practiced, and in some, and even then, in some, sometimes until it's implemented, you won't find all of the cracks. Practice and constant renovation of it in order to ensure that those holes or cracks are taken care of is absolutely essential. And so, you know, I think it's incredibly important that disaster recovery, business continuity drills are not planned events which are casual walkthrough. They need to be very rigorous, sometimes surprise level activities that really will point to the issues that you may have in a true disaster.
For more fantastic interviews directly related to your business, be sure to explore Meet the Boss TV.